There are so many different salts out there in the supermarkets, and I've gotten a lot of comments from you guys about what salts to use and what to do if you over or under salt your food. The most common salts I have over here, and this is iodized table salt. So this is what you typically see in restaurant shakers, or maybe you even have one of those on your kitchen table. And next to it, I have its cousin, I would say, and that is kosher salt, coarse kosher salt. Now, going back to this normal table salt, it has iodine added to it, and that was in like the 1920s. Iodine was added to help prevent some devastating iodine deficiencies in the United States. This table salt is also really processed. You can tell by the texture here of the salt itself. It's very uniform and almost rounded in shape. And that means that the salt has undergone some processing that kind of knocks out all of the jagged edges of the salt crystal and makes it really easy to dissolve. So if you're cooking something, if you're putting it into pasta water, it dissolves really quickly. Now, kosher salt is something we here in the test kitchens love to use. Why? Because you can easily pinch it and sprinkle it on your foods. It has a coarse texture to it, but it's almost an irregular texture. There's some fine particles of salt, but there's also some bigger crystals here. Now, in our recipes and in a lot of recipes, they'll call for coarse salt, and it's important that you take note of that. And if you don't have coarse salt in your kitchen and you want to substitute this table salt here or a finer salt, you need to be mindful and not use as much. So if a recipe calls for 1 teaspoon of coarse kosher salt and you're using table salt here, you probably want to start with at least half. So one more thing here, got a lot of questions about over or under salting, and my best piece of advice for you would be to season as you go. Season a little bit, taste it. Does it need more salt? Maybe you should hold off. That's the best piece of advice. Season as you go. So these are the two most common salts I would say that we use in the test kitchens, but out there are a lot of other salts that we like to call finishing salts. And finishing salts are kind of broken up into two different categories. There's either sea salts or there are mined salts. And across the world, I would say that the production of salt comes from half from the sea and half from mining them out from the earth. Now, this salt I have here, this is actually a sea salt. It's one of our favorite finishing salts here in the test kitchen. It's called Maldon salt. It comes from the south coast of England, and it has the biggest, most beautiful flakes to it. So it's extremely coarse, and that's part of the reason why we love it, because it does something that kosher and table salt, it doesn't do. It gives texture to things. So if you're sprinkling this on a salad, or if you're finishing it over some grilled steak slices, this gives a wonderful crunch, which is kind of an unexpected texture, but really delicious. And also, it gives off a little bit of an extra flavor. So not only is it salty, but it has its own flavor to it because it picks up the flavor from its environments. Now, a cousin to this sea salt here is over here. This is called sel gris, meaning gray sea salt. And this comes from the west central part of France. And you can see it's characteristically gray because it picks up a lot of that color from the environment in which it's harvested. Now, it is harvested in what they call these salt ponds, and that is just an area or a marsh, I would say, of salty water. And what happens is evaporation takes place, and all of the salinity, all of the salt, starts to crystallize. Now, what floats to the top and forms as the purest crystals of salt is the cousin of sel gris, which is fleur de sel, meaning the flower of the salt. And you can see I have two versions here, a very fine version of fleur de sel, and I also have a coarse version of it here. You can see there's a big difference in the color. It's much brighter and whiter in color, and the crystals are very beautiful on this coarse version I have over here. Now, this sel gris is actually the salt that kind of settles down in these evaporation pools. So it's manufactured in the same way, but one's kind of on top and one is on the bottom. In contrast to these sea salts, We have some other salts here that are colored salts, and they're called colored salts because they actually pick up the color from the environment in which they're harvested. So this is a Hawaiian black salt, and the black comes from the lava that it is surrounded with. So it's actually kind of mixed in with the salt as it's harvested, and that gives a really distinct flavor. You get a lot of mineral compounds, you get a lot of subtle earthy flavors to go along with it. This is Himalayan pink sea salt. It sounds kind of crazy because we're in the Himalayan mountains, right? And where's the sea around it? But it's actually ancient seas have evaporated over time, and all that salt is left behind, and it picks up this wonderful hue, this pink color from the surrounding earth. Now, colored salts, we're going to move on to flavored salts over here. There are countless flavored salts, and these are actually combined with other ingredients, not necessarily naturally occurring in the environment in which they're harvested. So this is a green tea salt here. This is a truffle salt, but most popular, I would say, in the United States. There's celery salt, which people typically use in their Bloody Marys. Lots of different flavored salts out there in the marketplace. These obviously have much more flavor. Now, the last salt I want to talk about, and this is for all of the fans out there who love to pickle and preserve, this is pickling salt. And you can see pickling salt is very fine, it's very bright, it shines, and it is a highly refined salt. So it's almost 100%, close to 100% sodium chloride. So very, very, very pure, and it dissolves easily since it's so finely ground into your pickling or brining solution. So there you go, guys. I hope I've helped you out here with a very simple glossary of all of the different salts, what you should do with them, how you should season as you go. And there you go, guys. Enjoy, salt away, and of course, if you have any kitchen conundrums, reach out to us using the hashtag #KitchenConundrums. We would love to hear from you.